It's a great pleasure to introduce Professor Roger Berkowitz. Many of you already know Roger, you've already worked with him. He's created a kind of parallel college off campus on Annandale Road with the Hannah Arendt Center, which brings him off campus so we don't get to see him as much, which is upsetting for us as colleagues and friends, but great for you, the students, because of what the great intellectual ferment that he's created with this center. Roger is not only a PhD in political theory, he's also a JD, so he gave up the riches of a career in law to enrich our minds and combine his sense of the practical workings of law with his theoretical underpinnings. And I have to say, as you know, his honors and achievements are many. He's the author of the important The Gift of Science, Leibniz and the Modern Legal Tradition, An Account of How the Rise of Science Has Led to the Divorce of Law and Justice, which was published by Harvard in 2005. He's published numerous important articles in journals like the Yale Journal of Law and the Humanities, the Journal of Politics, New Nietzsche Studies, etc., etc. He's really becoming a public intellectual in very high-profile venues all across the nation. As Roger's friend, I can just say this. He built the Arendt Center brick by brick over long years in many grant proposals, and I saw all the labor that went into it. And to see what he's done when he has these conferences with leading figures from all across the, not just the academy, you know, our world, the ivory tower, but also from the worlds of culture and writing and business and finance, it's very exciting. I think, enrich the life of the colleges in ways that we can't really fathom. So I think it's a great pleasure and honor, and let's introduce Professor Berkowitz. Thank you very much.
That should be there for many reasons, but also someone whose thought really defines the first year seminar curriculum. Some of you may know that her husband, Heinrich Bucher, taught here for many years, and he was one of the people who helped set up FISEM and the idea of the FISEM curriculum at Bard. And it very much fits with her idea of what education should be. For her, education has two, in a sense, conflicting goals. On the one hand, we welcome students into the world. And the world is the world we live in, which is the world of the present, but also the world of the past. And her claim is, we can't tell them how they should be in the future because we don't know the future. We shouldn't presume to know the future. So education, she says, is sort of conservative. We teach you about the world we're in, the past, so that you then can rebel against it and go and make the world of the future. And FISEM is very much in that spirit. It's teaching you the world, the intellectual world that we all here come out of. Not because it's what will be relevant or important for the future necessarily, but because you need to be part of the world we're in so that you can then remake it and renew it. Extent that's necessary. It's an old-fashioned goal, and yet it's an important one. And it's one that is more and more at threat. I don't know how many of you saw just 2 or 3 days ago in the New York Times reports that Stanford and Harvard and MIT are setting up dueling online universities. The idea is that for very little money, much cheaper than we can provide it, you'll be able to go and take all the courses at MIT, Harvard, Stanford, University of Pennsylvania, etc., online. And I have nothing against that. I think there are certain things that online education can teach quite well, probably better than, you know, face-to-face. And yet the idea, which is being talked about, that more and more of us, and in the future more and more of you and your children, will be educated by machines, and by educated by sometimes professors behind machines, but also sometimes just by machines, who will actually, machine artificial intelligence will teach these courses, is one that, again, some parts of it will not be terrible, but we need to take seriously. And it may be that the age of FISAM at a college like Bard is very much endangered. And for that reason, it's a pleasure to be here. It's also important for us to realize that the world is changing, and it's changing fast. And we often turn to technology to help understand it and help deal with it. And we become ever more dependent upon technology, as we do. And so the question that I've put forward to talk to you about today, and it's a question that was very dear to Arendt's heart, is, in a sense, how does this increasing reliance on technology, on machines, change our human world? What would it mean if your children are taught by machines? Would that change who they are and how they are as human beings? So another way to frame it is, what does our increasing dependence in relation to machines mean for the human condition? There are a lot of ways to approach that question, but one way to begin is with Garry Kasparov. Garry Kasparov was, for many years in the late 20th century, the best chess player in the world. And he happened to have the distinction of being the best chess player in the world at the time that IBM developed Deep Blue, which is a computer that plays chess. And in 1997, Deep Blue beat Garry Kasparov in a match. It was the first time ever that an artificial intelligence, if we want to call it that, machine, beat a grandmaster, and not only the grandmaster, but the best chess player in the world. So Kasparov was a very brilliant man, besides a great chess player, and he thought a lot about, what does it mean that machines are beating men and people? And what is the importance? How is it changing chess? Is chess becoming less human or more human? And in thinking about it, he said a couple things. He said one thing is that traditionally, what made a good chess move was not simply that it was going to help you win, although that was important, but that it was bold and elegant. And part of that was also useful, because bold and elegant moves were surprising. And, you know, chess is timed, and it throws your opponent off. They're like, I haven't seen that before. What am I going to do? But he says, once computers become your opponents and computers enter chess, there's no use in a bold or elegant move, because the computers can calculate in about a nanosecond all the possible combinations, and it loses any element of surprise. And so chess becomes less surprising, less elegant. And a good move is simply one that works. It's not one that can surprise someone. He also says something very interesting, which is that computers in chess neutralize the advantages of age and wisdom. You know, if you want to learn chess as a six-year-old now, you can basically play against a computer who will give you every great game in the history of chess and run you through it. The result of that is that chess grandmasters are younger and younger. In 1958, Bobby Fischer became the youngest grandmaster in the history of chess, at the age of 15. That record held until 1991. Since 1991, there have been over 35 grandmasters under the age of 15, including Sergei Krajakin, who in 2002 became a grandmaster at the age of 12. The point is that It's much easier at a young age to acquire information much faster and faster. And since the information acquired is logical and not based on surprise or elegance, the value of wisdom is being diminished in the game of chess. Kasparov tells, I think, a very interesting story. He says he played two matches against Veselin Topalov, who was a Bulgarian, who was a champion of the world at this time. Kasparov had retired. And when they played human against human, Kasparov beat him 3-1. He was the better player. But when they played a match where they both could use a computer to help analyze the moves, they came to a draw. It was 3-3. And what he concludes from this, Kasparov, is that, you know, someone who's smarter, someone who's more of a genius, someone who's got more calculating ability than the others, that talent is neutralized in the current age. We're much more equal because we all have Google right next to us. And so if you've gone to good colleges and memorized all the stuff, or you've gone to medical school and remembered all the diagnoses, that's great. But if the other guy can just check the computer, that advantage, all that hard work, isn't so important. And so he says, we get rid of the advantage of genius and of intelligence to a certain degree. We equalize things, which could be good or bad. And so you might think that's pretty dire. He has a pretty dire view of it, but he doesn't. He says, in the end, a computer, a chess computer like Deep Blue, it's just a big machine. It calculates. It doesn't think. It's not creative, he says. And he says, as long as we keep that in mind, what we remember is, yes, computers will change chess, but in a sense, it'll free us humans up from having to memorize all those facts and moves and figures, and we can spend that time being more creative. And so he sort of has a hope or a faith that that creativity and humanity will persevere, even in the age of computerized chess. And I want to think about that, and I want to offer you two other machines that have been in the news recently that raise some questions about Kasparov's hope there. One is the question-answering machine devised by IBM Watson. You could say he's Deep Blue's heir or nephew or grandson. They're both IBM machines. As I'm sure some of you might know, Watson played Jeopardy against the world's leading Jeopardy players 2 years ago and beat them handily. Jeopardy is not just chess. It's not where you have rules and you move moves, you know, pieces in a rule-like way, but you actually have to answer questions with human language, and you have to think about puns and different things. So it's a much more kind of intelligent machine. Not only did Watson win in Jeopardy, he's now gone to medical school. And his name is now Dr. Watson. And he's now being used at leading hospitals around the country to diagnose illnesses. And, you know, you come in, you say, here's the symptoms, and he says, oh, there's a 43% chance you have this, and a 62% chance you have this. And he's doing this based on a fair bit of information. He's read and memorized every single medical textbook of the last 500 years, including also some from Greece and the classical era. And in all languages, and also folk remedies, and he reads all blogs on medicine every day. And so the man knows a lot. And IBM says, don't worry, doctors. He's not a doctor. He's just a tool. The doctors are going to make the final decisions. But come on. I mean, you go to med school, and you cram, and you cram, and you cram, and you get all this information in your head, and then you, of course, start to forget it. He's never going to forget it. You get tired. You stay up at night, diagnosing patients, or working in the ER. He doesn't get tired. How is it going to really pay all these doctors to keep memorizing all this information when they have Watson next to them? Not so likely. And so who will be able to beat him? And then the question becomes, you know, who will be the doctor? And then there's another machine. Some of you, I'm not sure how many of you know who Aaron is. Aaron is that thing on the bottom. Aaron is an artist. He's the creation of Harold Cohn, an artist at San Diego and a professor of computer science and art at San Diego State University. And for the last about 40 years, Aaron has been painting. He doesn't know what he's going to paint, By the way, I went to a documentary yesterday and saw a trailer for the new movie on Gerhard Richter. I don't know if any of you have seen this new movie, Gerhard Richter on Painting. And you know, one of the things that Gerhard Richter says is, I never know what I'm going to paint before I start. I throw something on the canvas, and then I go from there. Well, that's actually exactly how Aaron paints. He starts with a random mark, and he's been taught over 35, 40 years, and he's taught himself in a certain way, how with random marks to fill in. And he now exhibits paintings like this at the Museum of Modern Art in New York, at the Tate Gallery in London, and at other major museums around the world. Seems like art. Here's Aaron painting one of his paintings that I have on the right, the pointing head of Harold Cohen, who built them. Cohen, very much like Kasparov, who says computers can't be creative, and very much like IBM, who says Watson is not creative, he's not a doctor, he's just a tool. Cohen says, I never claim Aaron can be creative. Interestingly enough, Stanley Fish, who some of you may know, he's a famous professor and cultural critic. He writes in the New York Times online quite a bit. When Watson came out and won at Jeopardy, Fish wrote a piece saying, don't worry about Watson. He's just a machine. He's a big laptop. He'll never think like human beings. So you have people like Cohen, people like Stanley Fish, people like Kasparov, all saying, ignore the question of how and whether those machines challenge our human nature and transform the human condition. They're just machines. What I want to suggest to you today is that that's a mistake. We should not ignore this challenge. There's something called the Turing test, which says that if you sit in a room here and I sit a barrier on the other side and we can't see each other and we have a conversation, if you're a computer and I can't tell you're a computer, you pass the Turing test, which means whether or not you're really thinking, I think you're thinking, right? I think you're a human being. And it may be the case that machines will never think. And when we get into all these conversations about can they think, should they be creative, I would say it's the wrong question. The question is not whether machines can be creative or whether they can think. It's, can machines consistently give us the illusion that they're thinking? Because if they start to give us the illusion that they're thinking and that they're creating, we start to believe it. So we start having machines do our work for us. We start having them teach for us. We start having them fight wars for us. We start having them raise our kids. And in one of my favorites, we start getting married to them. Some of you may not know this, but there is a lot of the people who've been arguing for the right for gays and homosexuals to get married are now turning to the next great civil rights crusade in their view, which is the right to marry robots. And there is a very active and vibrant right to marry campaign for robots. And the argument is that they're better spouses. They don't get angry, they clean up, they help raise the kids, they can stay up all night. And there's a lot of people out there who really want to legally marry their robots. I mean, go figure, but it's true. And so the illusion, whether or not they're really real, is really human, is sort of irrelevant. If the illusion is real, they seem human. We let machines do the art, they let machines love us and love, we let them think, we start to see them as human. And what is more, we humans start to see ourselves in the model of machines. We start to act more and more machines because we idolize the machines. They're faster than us, they're smarter than us, they're more efficient than us, they're more durable than us, they're objective. And we think, can't we just be like them? And it starts to change what it means to be human. There's no one who idolizes machines more than this guy. Anyone know who that is? Ray Kurzweil. Some of you, Ray Kurzweil is an inventor. He invented the Kurzweil keyboard and also a reader for blind, for the blind people can read. He's an extraordinarily brilliant man. 2 years ago on this very stage, he gave a great talk on this very topic, which you can watch at the Hannah Arendt Center website. He has become the great prophet and promoter of the idea that machines, in many ways, are better than humans. But more than that, that machines and humans can and should merge. What he talks about is the coming era of the machine-human civilization. In this new coming era, we humans will become machine-like, and machines will become humans, such to an extent that eventually we won't be able to tell the difference. We will have bodies that either we don't need because we can live purely ethereally in a computer, or we can make the bodies whatever we want them to be. We will have brains that have nanotechnology and wired technology chips in them, so we will be able to think with the speed that even the fastest supercomputers today can't think, because computers will design the new computers, and they will be faster and better than we could ever imagine. We'll be able to reverse engineer the brain. We'll have neural implants that allow us to feel better and sense better. We'll have nanotechnology blood cells so we can run marathons in an hour and not break a sweat. And we will eventually be cyborgs. That's the goal. And he thinks it's happening, and it will probably happen, in his view, within the next 20 to 30 years. And it's not only that we remake our bodies, and not only that we remake our brains. I don't know how this is. Let me start this over and see if I can get it to view so you can read the whole screen. No? Don't worry, that's how. I'll do my best to read it for you.
Do you want us to have it on the laptop screen?
I don't think it's that screen. I think it's the computer for some reason is promoting it perfectly. So what this slide says, if you read it, is so it would appear that intelligence is more powerful than physics. Such a civilization will then overcome gravity and other cosmological forces and engineer the universe it wants. The point is that all the things we see around us, the wood, the metal, the screens, we will turn these things into intelligent, smart matter. And all we'll have to do is push a button, and things will change shape. And if we worry about global warming, all we have to do is create new mountains, and create new clouds, and create new life forms that will eat up the problematic ozone-causing chemicals. And we will, in a sense, be able to make the whole world that we want. Do you believe it? Well, Freeman Dyson, who some of you may know, is a physicist and public intellectual, and is one of the people most interested in this phenomenon. He wrote this about 2 years ago in New York Review of Books. If this dream comes true, and he thinks it will, and a new art form emerges from it, and the new art form is computer biology, a new generation of artists writing genomes as fluently as Blake and Byron wrote verses might create an abundance of new flowers and fruit and trees and birds to enrich the ecology of the planet. Point is, you guys, a lot of people here study art, but the new art is going to be, painting and drawing and sculpting with genomes. And we're going to be able to create beautiful life forms and beautiful new stages and beautiful little buildings that will grow. So that we will create a world that's not only has cyborgs in it, but the cyborgs will then be able to run the world intelligently. But what then is left for human beings if this were to happen? Well, Kurzweil has an answer, and this is his answer. If you wonder what will remain unequivocally human in such a world, it's simply this quality. Ours is a species that inherently seeks to extend its physical and mental reach beyond current limitations. This might sound familiar. Maybe someone like Prometheus thought this way. The idea of the Greek god Prometheus, he gave humans fire against the directives of justice, or of Zeus, depending on which tale you can read. You might also think of Adam and Eve. Eve rebelled against limits and sought to go beyond, extend our mental reach beyond limitations and pick the fruit, the forbidden fruit of knowledge. And so, in many ways, Kurzweil gives us an old-fashioned, deeply human idea of what makes us human. We humans grow, we extend, we exceed our limitations. But of course, there's a difference. Because Prometheus got strapped to a rock and had a vulture in his liver for 30 years. And Eve, well, she didn't come out so good. And we're all paying the price since then. Since we fell. The point is that there was punishment for the idea of human hubris. And Kurzweil often leaves that part out. He simply thinks it's all going to be good and doesn't worry about what the other consequences might be. So as I said, this is an old-fashioned idea in a certain way, and not completely. And it's helpful, therefore, maybe to compare it to maybe the classical expression of humanity in the classical age and up through to the present. A couple of others. Let me start here with Sophocles' Ode to Man, which is a choral ode from Sophocles' tragic song or play, The Antigone. It's an attempt for Sophocles to answer the question, what is the human condition? And so let me read for you this poem briefly. Manifold are the wonders. Nothing towers so wondrous as man. He it is that is bold, mid the surges high to sail, blown by the stormy gale, white crests of ocean to span. Earth, the unwearied too, highest of gods supreme, man wears away as through all the years plowing the ground, he follows round and round the slowly furrowing horses. So there's a couple things to notice in this first stroke. So the poem, let me just back up and say, the poem is composed of two strokes and two antistrokes that talk to one another. So in this first stroke, we get the wonders of man. He's great. He can sail the seas, and he can crest the ocean, and he's like the highest of gods supreme. And he can, you know, pretty much do anything. And the way that he's described is with this Greek word, which is cut off at the end there, deinon. There's just an N missing. And deinon is a very important word in Greek, and in this poem, it means, on the one hand, wondrous, what is amazing, what's strong, what's powerful. On the other hand, it means what's terrible and what's fearful. And so here we're saying, man is the most wondrous and most terrible creature. So here you get the wonder. But here in the antistrophe, you get the terror. The flocks of the light-hungry birds and traveling he hunts, and the wild animals and sea creatures he ropes into nets. The man who knows his way around, he overpowers with his devices the animals of the mountains and the rough maned horse. He ties a yoke around its neck. And the unbending mountain road, yoked to the plow, he breaks. So if you get wonder in the first, here you get sort of the terror, how we can, in a sense, terrify and make fearful all the other creatures in the world on Earth. And then we move to the second strophe and antistrophe, which are really the culmination come through in two paired lines. And I'm going to point these out to us. So here's the second stroke. And speech he taught himself, and Winsmith thought, and order and law for government, and shelter from missiles of frost, and sleep he had brought. Always overcoming on his way, he comes to nothing when he seeks to escape from death. Man survives, soothes, nobles, conquers the will, and cures from baffling diseases he well can devise, save for death, death alone, ere baffles his skill. So, once again, man can do a lot. He can create government, he can speak, he can think, he can create houses, he can cure diseases. But one thing he can't do is conquer death. It's interesting to point out in this regard that Kurzweil thinks that we will conquer death, and very soon. He says that he plans to live till he's 700 years old. And he says that he could live longer, but he thinks 700 is a good number. Why, I don't know. But that's what he said. And he says that a lot of people say, oh, well, you know, it's important to die. Dying is important. But that's just because we've never had any choice. Once we have a choice, people aren't going to want to die. Something to think about. But what I wanted to point out here is this middle verse, slowly overcoming on his way, he comes to nothing. I know the classicists here in the audience are going to jump down my throat, but the Greek words for this line, or at least the first part of it, are these cut off, pantoporos, pantoros. And I don't have the reading on the A, so I'm sorry, I couldn't figure out how to get it on the computer. What this means, poros is ways, pantos is all, it's a primitive, so it's going all ways, he loses the way. So that's my translation. Going all ways, he loses the way. The point here is that man is this amazing, wonderful creature who can go all ways. But the point of man is that he goes on ways that are there. But if he goes all ways, there's no left ways left for him to go on. If he conquers death, if he goes always, what else is there to do? He loses the way. He ceases to be man. And so, this is sort of you'll see how important this is when you read the next paragraph, in the next epistrophe, because there's an answer to it, which is the same formulation in the middle, and I'll just read it and then mention it again. Inventive and skillful, but subtly surpassing belief, he stumbles at times on the good, now and bad. Between the laws of the earth and the sworn justice of God, he goes, and here's the main line, towering high over the polis, he loses the polis. He who comes to nothing for the sake of a bold vengeance. Let it not be close to me at the hearth, nor equate his illusion with my knowledge, he would bring that to work. So first of all, notice the Greek is the same formulation, the same kind of sentence structure. Instead of pantoporos, paporos, it's now hypsipolis, apolis. Towering over the polis, he loses the polis. Towering over the politics, that which holds us together as human beings, we lose the polis. What does that mean? It means that on the one hand, man is that animal who can create a politics, bring people together. On the other hand, that man is that animal that can destroy a polis, that can act criminally, that can act boldly and dangerously, and tear a community apart, which is why we want men nowhere near us. Let it not be close to me at the hearth, nor equate his delusion with my knowledge. Who would bring that to work? We want to keep those Danon, those wondrous men, actually pretty far from us, because they can be quite dangerous. So what is man for Sophocles? He's Danon, he's wondrous, but at his essence, he's the being who can create politics, but also destroy politics. And let's just remember what politics is for the Greeks. It comes from the Greek verb helein, which is the verb that was used by the Greeks to describe smoke rings going up academic circles. Why is that about politics? Because politics is that activity that unites a group of diverse citizens around a common center that holds them together. The North Pole, the South Pole, a pole is that which people revolve around, or the earth revolves around. Politics is that center that holds a community or a polis together. And for Sophocles, man is this wondrous creature who can do many things. He can create polises, but he can also destroy them. Following on Sophocles, one of the next great thinkers of the human condition is Aristotle, who basically, on one level, repeats Sophocles, man is a political animal. But he adds something. First of all, he calls him an animal, which Sophocles never did. And secondly, he says he's a living being capable of speech, of logos, of reason and speech, and talking. And this addition of being an animal and of having speech will come to be important in history. We next have Thomas Aquinas, who says, sounds again very much like Aristotle and Sophocles, man is by nature political. But then he adds, that is social. And we have to understand that by social, what Aquinas means is, whereas political is a world of equals, entering and gathering and talking about what we should do in the polis on the agora in Greece, social is the realm of the household, where the father or the controls everyone, or the king, or the pope, or God. So when Aquinas says that man is by nature political, that is social, he changes the meaning. It's not just the people coming together around a common center. It's people who are ruled in common. And so ruling and being ruled becomes part of humanity for Aquinas. Then we come to Immanuel Kant, who says, now I say that man, and in general, every rational being, exists as an end in itself, not merely as a means. Now, I do this little diagram for you. What he means by that is that man is a rational being. That's exactly what Aristotle said. He's an animal with logos that thinks. Kant says he's a rational being. But what Kant means by this is a little different, because he says we are a split being. On the one side, we're rational. We act and think like God, rationally. On the other side, we have sensible desires, urges. And he says, we must, in a sense, subordinate our sensible side to our rational side. We must become an end for ourselves. And since we are rational beings, reason is our end, is our goal. And so our rational side is our end, and we subordinate our sensible side. And what Kant says is, that means we're free. Why is it free? Because we give ourselves the law. And the law is in ourselves, because we are an end for ourselves. And we are rational beings. And so Kant says to be human is to be free. The next great thinker of the human condition is Karl Marx. And here we get another deviation, another change. So Marx says the first historical act of men in which they distinguish themselves from animals, so once again, from Aristotle, from Marx, we're distinguishing ourselves from animals, is not that they think. Now that's a surprise, because Aristotle, Aquinas, and Kant think that it's our rationality that we think that distinguishes us from animals. But now we're told that what distinguishes us is that we begin to produce our means of existence. We create the tools and the institutions that make life easier and more comfortable. And so we still are different from animals in the sense that we can create the new, better world, but it's not a world of thinking, it's a world of differences between all of these thinkers, all of these humanisms share a basic structure, namely that man is special. He's distinct. He must somehow become aware of his specialness and actualize it. So for Sophocles, man is Danon, which means he can create polices, and he must do so. For Aristotle, he's a political animal. For Aquinas, he's a social animal and must be ruled. For Kant, he's autonomous and must actualize his freedom. And for Marx, he must actualize a socialized man, a man for whom everything is in abundance and is ready and there for him. For all of these thinkers, man is special. And man must, and this specialness must be actualized. And I would suggest to you that that's a pretty good definition of the humanist tradition. The humanist tradition is, man is different from animals. He's special, and we should applaud that. And then what I want to tell you is that the humanist tradition has come to an end. It's come to a full break. One example of that break is Darwin. Darwin writes, man may be excused for feeling some pride at having risen, though he still bears in his bodily frame the indelible stamp of his lowly origins. See, for Darwin, man is not special. He's one species among many. And there's no reason to think that he'll be the highest. Just because he's currently the highest doesn't mean that we won't have another evolutionary period at which man will we will evolve higher than man. Which is, by the way, exactly what Kurzweil thinks we're currently doing. The use of machine technology in human beings, Kurzweil says, is simply replacing natural selection with human-oriented selection, which is a kind of breeding and creating of better human beings, which we are doing and will continue to do from his point of view. This is deeply important because from a Darwinian perspective, if there's nothing special about man, there's no reason that we think man has much dignity. And so we see, for those of you who's going to study human rights in part, one of the things you'll be confronted with is that human rights thinkers have given up the ability to justify why humans have rights. And the reason they have given that up is because they no longer believe that there's a reason that humans have rights. And one of the problems that human rights thinkers are confronted with is that they can't seem to make a distinction between human rights and animal rights and plant rights. And so the human rights community largely says, look, let's just not talk about it. And on a practical level, let's fight for human rights. But there's a lot of people who say that doesn't work. We have to justify it. Darwin kicks out one of the crutches that allowed us to say that humans were special and deserved special rights. Another example of this break, or this end of the human condition, is Galileo. And here you have Galileo's telescope, or some rendering of it. The philosopher Alfred North Whitehead, who's one of the great writers on the history of science, had this to say about Galileo's telescope. Since a baby was born in a manger, it may be doubted whether so great a thing has happened with so little stir. Of course, the babe in the manger brought about some changes in the new world. And the argument that Whitehead makes, and also that Hannah Arendt makes, is that Galileo's telescope is the single most important event that defines the human condition in the modern era. So what is new? What is Galileo's? Do we still read Galileo in Chrysler? Yeah. So you've all seen this picture. This is the drawing that Galileo does of the moon after he invents the telescope and spends 3 or 4 months so new? What's so impressive about this telescope? Well, as we know, since you've read it, people before Galileo thought that the moon was perfect and thus flat. And Galileo looks at the moon with the telescope and sees dark spots and light spots. And he notices that the dark spots are turned towards the sun. And he says, oh, there must be mountains on the moon. That's what I thought when I saw it. And I, you know, you look at that and say, he never saw the mountains. How did he know there were mountains on the moon? And how did he calculate that the mountains on the moon were going to be 4 miles high? Which turns out to be pretty close to right there. The highest one, as far as I understand it, is 3 miles high. And he did all this without seeing the mountains. Well, how do you know that? And why is it important? Well, he says, I can paraphrase a little bit, but the telescope delivers the secrets of the universe to the human mind with the certainty of sense perception. Now, what does that mean, the certainty of sense perception? It's obviously a paradox in a certain way, because sense perception, he's just shown us, is not certain. For thousands of years, we looked at the moon and thought it was flat. Now, we learned that those senses and sense perception has lied to us. So one thing it tells us is that the human senses are not enough. We saw the moon is flat. We see the sun move. We see the wood here on the stage is solid. And yet we know that the earth, the moon is not flat. The sun doesn't move. Earth moves around the sun, and this wood is filled with empty spaces. So what's the lesson that we take from Galileo's telescope? It's that human sense perception is not true. Even what we see in the telescope isn't true, because we didn't see mountains. We just saw dark and white spots. Truth doesn't come from sense perception. It comes from calculations. It comes from knowing the laws behind that govern the senses. In other words, Galileo didn't throw us, as many people think, back on our senses. Yes, there was an age of observation that emerged, but the observation does not throw us back on our senses. He frees us from our senses. He frees us to the world of science, which is not a world of sense perception, but a world of calculation, of mathematics. Think back to Plato, right, who says that the truth is what is supersensible and eternal, because we know that what changes on Earth is not true. Well, for the scientist and for Galileo, it's not just ideas that can be true. All things, right, the wood, the jacket, people, their truth is there, it just has to be discovered. And it's not going to be discovered through senses, it's going to be discovered through thinking, through calculation, through finding the unalterable laws that govern things. So what Galileo teaches us is that the truth of the world is beyond everyday human sense perception. In other words, the truth of the world is inhuman. Increasingly, what this means is that we live in a world that we don't understand. And here we finally get to Hannah Arendt. And she writes in The Human Condition, "The trouble concerns the fact that the truths of the modern scientific worldview, though they can be demonstrated in mathematical formulas and proved technologically, will no longer lend themselves to normal expression in speech and thought." So, you go on an airplane. Do you know how it flies? Yet you get on it, right? You go up a skyscraper. You don't know why it still stands, but you go. You use Wi-Fi. You don't know how it works. You rely on statistics and data. And really, who understands them? You know, there may be some couple of scientists in the world who really understand how Wi-Fi works. But they may not be the same ones who understand how the airplane works, or how the data works, or statistics work. The point is, we all are increasingly living in a world which is inexpressible in normal speech and thought to most of us. Now you could say, oh yeah, well that's true forever. The Greeks and the Egyptians, they couldn't understand the world, so they invented gods. True. But there's a big difference. The Greeks and the Egyptians knew they couldn't understand the world, and that they couldn't, so they invented gods. We know in our hearts that the world is comprehensible, that it's understandable, and that if we're smart enough and spend enough time studying, each one of these things we could understand. But we don't do it, we can't do it, and so the world begins to strike us as inhuman, as, in a sense, unknowable, ununderstandable, and distant. So that what Galileo and Darwin share, what they both do to us as human beings, is they share a faith in an objective and scientific truth that is inhuman, that is beyond the capacity of humans to understand. A truth free from human perception. A truth that's universal, that's true on the moon, and it's true at the nanotechnology level. It's a truth that matters for all beings, including human beings. And when we look at man, therefore, Arendt argues, as a scientist looks at man, we look at man in the same way that we look at, that a scientist would look also at rats. There's no difference. So, one more big quote from Arendt that I will read you. This is not from The Human Mission, this is from an essay she writes called The Conquest of Space. In the last paragraph of it. Seen from a sufficient distance, the cars in which we travel and which we know we built ourselves will look as though they were, as Werner Heisenberg once put it, as inescapable a part of ourselves as the snail's shell is to its occupant. All our pride in what we do will disappear in some kind of mutation of the human race. The whole of technology seen from this point, in fact, no longer appears as the result of a conscious human effort to extend man's material powers, but rather as a large-scale biological process. The point here is that if you look at man in a scientific way, as a scientist would look at man, you look at man as just another being, as just another moving being in the world like rats, who does certain things, who goes to school, who goes home, who takes care of kids, who has kids, who dies, who lives, etc. And you start to think, yeah, these men all pretty much do the same thing. And so what do we then start to do? We develop new kinds of sciences, like the social sciences, economics, political science, sociology, anthropology, psychology. And what do these sciences do? They look for regularities, normalities. They look at large numbers of people and say, how do people behave? And they treat people largely like we treat rats. Some of you may know what a scatter graph is, right? A scatter graph is a graph in which you point, you can put lots and lots of data points on the graph. And what Leibniz, Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz, proved in the late 17th century is that no matter how randomly you put those points on a graph, you can create a mathematical curve to map them. Extraordinary insight. But what it means today is, if you're a social scientist, no matter how different human beings are, once you plot their activities on a graph, you can normalize it, and you can, in a sense, take the differences out. And so, we start to think of humans as people, as people who don't act surprisingly, we increasingly, anyone who does something new or different today, like the Egyptian revolution, what do we immediately say? Oh, it's sort of like another revolution. Compare it to another one, and we take out the surprisingness of it, we take out the difference of it. We're very good as historians and as social scientists at, in a sense, taking away novelty, taking away newness, taking away rarity, and we make people more and more normal, such that humans themselves are not that interesting or important. So you have even people like environmentalists who say, we should stop studying humans. The thing is to study the world, right? And if we want to study the world, we should realize that the biggest threat to the world is humans, and we would do much better to just get rid of most of them, which is a widely held environmental view. In any case, for Arendt, and what I'm trying to suggest to you today, the greatest fact of our time, the most important thing to realize today about the human condition, is the loss of human distinction. The loss of the uniqueness of humans. You know, if any of you go into marketing, you'll learn very quickly, you don't need to know, who this person is. All you need to know is their zip code and their income. And you can pretty much sell them anything. You go on Facebook, and you pick your friends, and you get your information according to algorithms. There's less and less desire for or need for people who are unique or different. And people who are made famous are mercilessly brought down. Machines are becoming more human, and the corollary of that is that humans are becoming more like machines. The human condition, this idea of deinon, of wonder, of great deeds, has been replaced by the idea that everything has a reason, and therefore that everything that is rational, is understandable, is predictable, is knowable, and in the end is uninteresting. And so the question that I'm going to try and leave you with today is what to do about this fact that our human condition is changing. For 8,000 or more years, depending on how old you think we humans are, the human condition has been that we live on the Earth, but we no longer need to live on the Earth. I don't know how many of you are part of the terraforming movement to colonize Mars, but it's there. Human beings have had bodies, but according to Kurzweil and many others, we won't need bodies much longer, and if we have them, they'll be artificial. Human beings have had biological intelligence, but according to the people I've been talking about, our intelligence will be made computer intelligence, and our biological intelligence will become ever less important. And, of course, human beings have been political for thousands of years. But increasingly, we exit politics and are happy to be ruled technocratically by bureaucrats and administrators who seem to look out for our best interest. Kurzweil, Kasparov, Fish, they tell us, don't worry, right? These computers are not going to be human. It's just another form of evolution. And yet, I'm suggesting that the idea that we're becoming cyborgs, smarter, faster, more creative, that we might live in a virtual reality that we can control and might be more excited. They say embrace it. It's our new human condition. But there's another approach that we at least have an option of picking, which is not to say no to it, because I don't think we can say no to it. It's not to reject it. It's not to